As in discussing among the panel also that how to make it so interesting that everybody is participating. So the next session is on SOCs are transitioning to cyber defense centers. And this topic is closer to my heart because 10 years back I started my career as a SOC analyst only. My journey in security started as an endpoint security analyst. And at that time, I realized that the most of the tools and capabilities which we used in SOC to cater to global customer security requirements were either asset-based or either threat-based. So either you were protecting an endpoint, or either you were protecting a server or a big infrastructure piece, or either you were working against an anti-malware. So you would have a system which is an anti-malware system. Then I have seen the transition. I changed some roles, then went into InfoSec sales, etc. I was selling integrated all these tools, asset-based and threat-based, together stitched in a piece. They're still being called as SOC. Now the world of big data came, ML came, AI came, analytics came, and suddenly companies started setting up cyber fusion centers, cyber defense centers. So I thought initially it's a marketing gimmick, etc. But when we started taking a deep dive in DSCI, that what actually is cyber defense center, and what would be the future of it, how it will be different traditionally from a SOC, why not debate it or deliberate it in a session in a conference in DSCI? So that's why the session is there on what is the difference between SOC and cyber defense center. I think the panelists are going to focus on this core differentiation, especially so that as a SOC specialist or as a security practitioner, you can understand that in future what cyber defense center would cater to when it comes to such a complex threat landscape. Not taking much more time, I would like to invite the panelists. First, we have the moderator of this session. He is Mr. Sheetal Mehta. He's VP and Global Head, Cyber Security and Risk Services, Wipro. Mr. Sheetal, if you can join us on the stage. And other panelists are Mr. Rohan Vadya. He is Regional Director of Sales India Cyber Arc. Mr. Sangamesh, he is Lead Manager, Information Security, Infosys, and he's a part of Cyber Defense Center team who is setting up a Cyber Defense Center in Infosys. And Mr. Bindu Madhava, he's an Associate Director, CDAC. Let's give a good hand for the panelists. And I have some announcements to make because now after these sessions, you'll have back-to-back sessions and people tend to be in the same room. So they will look at the agenda and say, okay, I'll be sitting in this room from 2 to 4:45. Okay, so but it's better that you look at the agenda and then you can even transit from one room to another based on your interests, etc. And other announcement that I would like to make is that if you are tweeting something or if you are updating something on social media, either the photographs or any learning, one statement learning, please use tags such as hashtag BPM2017 or use hashtags such as cognitive security so that it can reach to a larger audience. And we also have a handle on Twitter @DSCI_connect. Okay, please use that. It's just a generic announcement that I wanted to make. Now over to Mr. Sheetal Mehta.
Good afternoon, all. Perfect. So you're still awake, I must say. Perfect. It's my privilege to host this session. I have quick introduction. I know Mayank has done it. I lead the cybersecurity and risk business globally for Wipro. My name is Sheetal Mehta. I do along with me have a set of eminent speakers. I will probably give them 30 seconds to quickly introduce themselves in their areas of expertise as well as the industry they come from.
Thanks, Sheetal. My name is Rohan Vaidya. I'm responsible for sales for CyberArk for India and SAARC region. And one task which Sheetal has given me is to keep you guys awake.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sangamesh, and I'm associated with Infosys. I lead the Cyber Defense Center for Infosys. I had recently transitioned security operations to the Cyber Defense Center.
Good afternoon. My name is Bindu Madhava. I am working for CDAC. CDAC is Center for Development of Advanced Computing. My main focus is on the SCADA security. So basically, the SIM for the SCADA space. So that is my forte.
Perfect. Thank you. So the folks who are on the standing at the back, there are seats in the front. You guys can even take the seats if you're okay. As I said, I'm aware that this session is immediately after lunch. So in order to make sure that we keep you live, I'm going to probably start with a story. Right? The subject that we are talking about is around transitioning SOCs, the Security Operations Center, to Future State Cyber Defense Center. And in my view, the important aspect is the keyword transition. In that sense, a change. So has anybody heard about this story around the rebirth of Eagle? Good. So let me articulate that story and then I'll transition out to. So eagles have, as a species, they have a lifespan of 70 years, right? A big lifespan. The good strength in terms of what they kind of drive for the period of 70 years. So as they move into their 40s, what happens is their beaks, which they actually use to eat and eat the prey, they start bending. Their jaws, the strength on the jaws starts reducing down, so they cannot pick up prey at the pace at which they have to pick up while flying. Their body becomes far, far more heavier, and their movement actually slows down. So as they move to their 40s, they have two options left. One is either die out. Second is transition or transform themselves. Right? So what do they do is that they actually really move ahead and fly out to a higher altitude. They kind of hit their beaks on a rock and break it apart and let new beaks come up. After the beaks come up, they actually do the same thing with their jaws and their claws and effectively get new set of claws and do the same thing with their wings, where they actually remove the wings, the feathers of their wings, to actually bring down their weight, overall weight. Right? This aspect really drives the level of rebirth again onto those eagles, and they actually are able to drive and fly for the next period of 30 years. Right? Now, if I take that context of what eagles have done to drive a change or drive a transition, we as proud cybersecurity professionals, we have the same role to play. Now, as professionals, our primary objective is to deliver the framework of trust to our customers, to our internal employees, in terms of way we secure and protect the data for them. Right? And this framework of trust is very, very crucial in changing business environments. It's important because the trust factor is something which delivers for the future. And with that thought process, let me ask Mr. Bindu, how do you see the changes in the cyber environment today? And what aspects are driving the same?
Yeah. I think I'll start with some sort of statistics, because that will help. So this is not mine. So this is the SANS report. It says around 58% of the organization reported spear phishing last year, out of which 13% was reported. So basically, that is one pointer what I just wanted to bring out. How the, even though the threat landscape in this particular scenario is changing every day, but what is happening is it is being detected, but reporting is lesser than whatever it has been detected. So this scenario is okay when there is the impact analysis which has to be done. So when you do an impact analysis, the impact was not big enough for coding. That might be the instance. Just as an extension to this, when we sort of collaborate or cooperate, especially in the so I'll take an example on that particular front. So if the impact which has to be measured on a critical infrastructure, that becomes very important. So even though it is a small impact that's reported, because it can have a socio-economic impact. It's not only the economic impact, it has a socio-economic impact. Actually, the so-called cyber threat landscape is changing every day. And it is no more the attacks will be single attacks. It will be a coordinated attacks. So it makes utmost important that how to handle this coordinated attacks. So with the changes of the threat landscape into a domain of coordinated attacks, and with the change of or with the collaboration of IT/OT, and as applied to some critical infrastructure, the threat landscape is totally different from what is existing today. So that is my view.
Thanks, Mr. Bindu. If I look at, if I just add to the point that he made, as per data points, which the industry is talking about, our industry is going to be approximately $1 trillion by 2021. And you would probably, most of you will agree with me that investments in cybersecurity by respective organizations have almost doubled in that sense, right? Yet, we had the firewall, the WannaCry's, which actually impacted one out of four companies worldwide, right? So something did not work. So, Mr. Sangamesh, what challenges do you see in driving these traditional SOCs?
The traditional security operations center has to cope up with the ever-changing business demands to combat the dynamic threat landscape. And especially gone are the days where we depend only on the log analysis and identifying the threats. Now it's more on doing analytics, bringing in the essence of threat intelligence and building the context to the incidents. So Cyber Defense Center is actually a next generation security operations center, which brings the power of correlation, analytics, threat intelligence, forensics, and also the counter intelligence. And Cyber Defense Center also interplays the process, people, and the technology. So it also brings in the additional flavor of information, which is actually intelligence, which actually marries with the existing processes to detect and profile threat actors, who is targeting the organization, and understand the motive and the objective of the attackers, so that the organization can strengthen their controls in for proactive protection, because we cannot prevent the attack, at least we can have the proactive protection in place and strengthen our controls.
Since you talked about the traditional SOCs, I have some more data points, and maybe these data points will resonate with some of you. So I was reading this SANS report, which just came out, the 2017 SANS report. That report, and I'm going to read certain data points so that you actually get a perspective around what I'm saying. It talked about approximately 45% of security operations centers. Only 45% actually have the capacity to detect unknown threats. And what more interesting came out of the report is 59% of security operations center actually use metrics for SOC performance. That's only close to 60 odd percentile, right? And of this 60%, approximately 80% of security operations centers perform these metrics manually, So think about the error factor that most security operation centers are running today. Right? With that, let me ask, what is the future that we are talking about? So let me ask Mr. Rohan, if you can help allude to us, what should be the vision for our future cyber defense centers and the broad strategy that we should apply for these defense centers?
So if you look at from a strategy or a vision perspective, the first thing if we start looking at and thinking about how an attacker thinks, or if we start thinking how does a cyber attacker think and we start building the defense around it, I think the possibility of reducing the risk is far higher. Now, when you look at the what does the cyber attacker look at or how does he think, he looks at probably three parts of any organization. It is people, it is processes, and it is a technology which is being used. Now, when we're looking at a vision, which is probably 5 years down the line or 10 years down the line where we want to be, if I start looking at what's in available with us in terms of the development on the technology, everybody's talking about automation, people are talking about AI, machine learning, and also, which is coming up very, very strongly, is the behavior and analytics. And if you start tying up these pieces together in reference to the next generation SOC, then we start looking at things like, okay, let me start analyzing the user behavior or the human behavior, analyze it with all possible tools which are still in development on the AI and the machine learning, correlate that external and internal data, and then start looking at an automation which will remediate the threats which are there. And the moment you start remediating, what you do is you take off a lot of load of the human interaction which happens, and you clear off the bandwidth for them. Now, from a people perspective, it's very important that we start relooking at what the current set of people in a SOC environment do, and start helping them or scaling them up to a level where they start looking at a continuous improvement, what is required to start building in things. When you have all these pieces coming in, your vision starts getting more clearer in terms of where we want to move. And as the attackers will keep getting sophisticated, it's a catch-up game which we can keep really being up to that.
That's great, Rohan. Let me ask the audience here. This is the second one, and you would have been inundated with all the buzzwords of cognitive, machine learning, artificial intelligence, deep learning. So how many of you use these techniques in your security operation centers today? Okay. Let's go a little deeper and try and analyze what these techniques can help us. So, Mr. Bindu, can you help us understand how we can leverage the techniques of cognitive, artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning techniques in our new center? And since you have a background with the critical infrastructure protection, if you can also lay in your views around usage of those techniques in those environments as well.
Yeah. So I think Sangamesh had brought out the tools which are used in the SOC centers, right? There is a lot of logs which has been generated, and these are in silos, and you have to sort of collect. That's what Rohan also was trying to say, and try to get a meaningful information out of it. So if you see by the engineering or the computer science perspective, so it is basically an identification problem, first a classification problem and an identification problem which has to be made, and then subsequently how to solve this particular problem which is there with the log analytics, which is having a multi-formatted space, and how do you correlate from this meaningful information. So for that, basically there is an important thing, or I think on a lighter way, people say that you should find a needle in the haystack. So this is the thing which people normally expect. Needle in the haystack can be found if the time is given. So if you got sufficient time, So you'll be able to find or classify or identify a particular thing. But imagine a scenario where it is time critical. So you have to do the complete cycle within a time period or a window. So how do you do this intelligently? So that is where the space of artificial intelligence comes into the picture. I think this artificial intelligence has been spoken from 1980 onwards, but it depends on how complex is the problem which you have to solve. So see a network, how complex it is, how many nodes it has got, how many links it has got, what are the different mechanisms of artificial intelligence techniques which can be used for and finding out a particular solution. Now, the second area is what is the buzzword is the big data analytics. There is different formats of data which is available, unstructured and structured. So you have to make some meaningful information of this particular unstructured and structured data by doing some pre-processing, and that's how you are going to arrive at some sort of meaningful information. That's how this, the total buzzword of, of course, the deep learning is another thing where you have got some sort of graph which has been formed, which is equivalent to your complex network architecture, and how you traverse across this particular graph to get a particular problematic area and how do you solve this particular thing. That's how these particular tools, based on the artificial intelligence techniques or the using the big data tools to do some sort of data mining on a unstructured data sort of scenario. So that is the thing.
Thank you, Mr. Bindu. I think what Mr. Bindu said really helps us solve the detection problem. We move from the process of being reactive to being proactive to being predictive in our detection process. So as we solve the detection problem, the next piece that we really need to look at is our response and remediation processes. And any views, there are a lot of market data points around the time it takes from a breach, the identification issue, the remediation process. Any views, any ideas? Come on, guys, I need you to be talking. Okay, so the data says that it takes approximately 100 plus days from when a breach is identified to when actually the breach is remediated, right? And approximately 30% of activities after an incident happens actually takes upwards of 2 to 8 days, right? That's a big chunk of activity even after the incident has been identified to act upon, right? So effectively, if we have to improve the impact to business, we really need to do something about our response and remediation processes. And that's where the function of automation and orchestration comes in play. Mr. Sangmesh, can you really help us understand how you can utilize the security automation orchestration in our new age cyber defense centers and probably articulate three areas where we can really take this to the next level?
Yeah, so security orchestration is playing a vital role in automation. Primarily, if you see the security orchestrations, its underlying concept is fully on automation of the manual task. And primarily, it's a capability and its potential can be used for automating the playbooks which we use in our security operations center. It primarily reduces the time in terms of correlating the data from different sources and the time spent by the analyst in analyzing the logs. So basically, the orchestration engine can be used for various other things considering the requirements. So in one of the use cases, what we have deployed is like, you know, one perspective of automating the playbooks. The other perspective is like cascading the intelligence with the different technologies. So ideally, all this next generation technology has the capability of collaboration, because bad guys collaborate and good guys, we are now collaborating, and we wanted the technology to collaborate with each other. Basically, we want to share the intelligence among ourselves and the technology, so that we are protecting ourselves and reducing the exposure of our infrastructure to the emerging threats. So with the security orchestrations, you can actually cascade the intelligence based on the feeds that you receive, either it could be a commercial or the open source. So you receive and make it available for the other technology to consume, so that you can protect your perimeter and the network.
Thank you, Mr. Sangmesh. So team, we covered the detection and response process through our, in terms of what changes have to happen through our cyber defense center. Let me probably kind of shift a little bit, and today morning I was talking to my son. He's a class 6 fellow at the age of 10. And I was talking to him about when is his exam. So their exams are coming in the first semester or first term exams. So he suddenly told me that he has a chapter on cybersecurity. Right? Can you imagine a class 6 fellow having a chapter on cybersecurity? I myself could understand what is cybersecurity 6 years or 5 years back. So this is a shift. This is a change. This is a shift that competencies have to go through as you look forward. And as you look into the new age cyber defense centers, competency plays a vital, vital role. Right? Mr. Bindu, if you can help us understand, what kind of competencies do you think we need for the cyber defense centers today?
Yeah, I think that was an awareness program for your son, which was there in the textbook. Now, if you see who is called the security professional today, he is an IT guy who has got some list of certification. So that's what is the basic thing, a qualification for an IT certified security professional. So what is majorly required is basically the reskilling of the complete gamut, the user, the developer. So these are two communities which has to be looked in a totality. So at the user level, you might want to sort of see that you have to have the competencies built, which is closer to whatever the standards which has to be followed and other things. In the space of development, these tools has to be sort of made real time, and to make it meaningful, I think the cycle time from detection to remedy was told by the chair moderator. So basically the 100 days is too a longer time. So how do you minimize this particular thing? So you should be able to have some sort of tools which are developed using the newer technologies. So reskilling is the mantra. So it is the domain specialist who has to get into more of the security space than the only the IT professional. So for example, if an utility sector fellow is there, a control engineer talking about security will have more meaningful than an IT guy talking about control security. So you have to do some sort of a skilling, reskilling at different level and different segment of the space. That is the
thanks, Mr. Bindu. Of course, along with changes to our detection and response processes, we definitely have to really upskill ourselves as we evolve ourselves. I will like to talk about another perspective, which we should actually, as cyber professionals, have to think through. How many of you here think that our role is a business-centric role? We impact the business directly. Good. So I also firmly believe this. Right? In fact, my company, Wipro, in their, I'm not sure whether you've seen the latest filings that they did with the US Security and Exchange. They actually talked about cybersecurity as a key risk to business in this year's filing. And that brings us a very interesting point. If we are impacting the business, we definitely need to have our performance indicators in place. And Rohan, if you can really help us, what kind of performance indicators we should really look at, and how should they enable the business in a direct sense?
So
So I'll take this question slightly differently. You know, in the common world, we talk about common sense not being very common. Now, if you look at the cyber world, I think it's the cyber security sense is not very common. So I think we need to have now a cyber security sense that we start developing. And that is something which probably your son is being taught in school or being made aware of. By the time he is back in his out of college, going to universities and then going to work, he is probably a far more cyber sensible person than what he would probably be. So if I look back in terms of and start categorizing the organizations that we work, or it may be small, large government, I can categorize these companies or organizations to three parts. One are companies which are, I would say, security compliant. Then there is a set of companies which are aware or security aware. And then there are very few which are security driven. Now, that pyramid is really, really heavy on the compliant piece which is there, be it here or be it in any Western world. Probably the pyramid needs to be, you know, inverted. And that is something which is going to change. And that, I would say, would be the first KPI which would really, really work. And that may not be a cybersecurity professional KPI, but as an organization which is there. Because it's always, the bad guys will always collaborate. And if we have to really play the catching game, then there is a challenge. If they are doing the catching game, then I think we are in a better situation we are. The second key indicator, I think, I believe, is very, very important, is from a competency transformation. Bringing in people from different walks of life, getting in a mathematician or a statistician into the cybersecurity space can make a lot of difference. Getting people from domains where we understand the industry domains much better, I think that's something which Bindu talked about. I think that's the second KPI that we should really focus on. And the third is the technology integration. I mean, I do come from a technology vendor background, but then there's so many of us who don't talk to each other. So that piece is another part of the collaboration or integration, whatever you want to term it or coin it. That's the third KPI. It may be at a very larger piece. And if we work on those directions, I think we would be able to move much faster than where we are at this point of time.
So you talked about collaboration a lot. I think in the room also we got to collaborate a little bit. So can I request all of you to stand up? Perfect. So now if you can look on the right and the left, shake hand with the other person, just introduce your name and your role. That will be very, very helpful. Perfect. Great. Absolutely. Thank you, guys. So I have woken all of you up. That's what my objective was. In the process, you also have collaborated, which is where my next point is. So I'm going to ask this question back to Rohan. And before I do that, Wipro as an organization, we just released a State of Cybersecurity Report 2017. And there were a couple of statistics we came across, very interesting statistics. And we asked a set of companies, a massive set of companies globally, in terms of what kind of data they would like to collaborate. And 80% respondents said they will definitely like to collaborate with generic threat information, informations which can be shared across the board, right? That 80% norm dropped down to approximately 44% as we started asking them, are you willing to share information which impacted your organization? And that's a big drop that we saw in terms of how collaboration can be handled, right? It's very important, if something has happened to you, also gets communicated to the ecosystem that you're in, and maybe the learnings that you had of the other environments actually can survive. That was a factor that we actually kind of picked up. So Rohan, how can you apply collaboration in a much more effective manner with these new cyber defense centers?
So collaboration is a word which, you know, has been there, I think, the time I went to school. And I think everybody says we collaborate, but we never collaborate. But what I learned back in school was, you know, I played a lot of sports. I probably captained about 9 teams. And I realized one thing: if you got to win, it's a team game. You like the guy, you don't like the guy, but when you are on the field, you got to be with him. Because if your objective is to beat the team and win the game, I think everybody needs to play their roles very well. There could be differences, but then you work through it and you make it happen. So one is cybersecurity is kind of becoming a team game. But I think it's for all of us in this room and beyond this room got to start putting in that effort to make it happen. I think one of the shake hands that you made everybody do, I think that was one of your KPIs that you ticked off from Wipro, saying, yes, I've made it happen. And I think if that's the kind of community we start building and be more happy and open about, not sharing problems, but basically trying to find solutions, that's going to be a better play for us in the future.
I have a question. You were saying that there was a considerable drop in percentage wherein people didn't want to share what had happened to them. So my question is, if something bad has happened to me and it has had a negative impact, why would I want to, you know, share that information? Isn't it a reputation image at stake?
That's precisely the point, that something has happened to you. You already had an impact on your reputation. And during the process, just because you have not communicated out in the broader industry that something has happened to you, you also have not subtly sent this information out. Right? Generic information versus pointed information can help the ecosystem in one way, shape or form. There are ways and means by which you can do it, but it goes back to the balance between your reputation, what you disclose, versus how you can do it in the right manner.
So how can we do it in the right manner?
If you look at the regulations which are coming in, I'm not sure whether you've read GDPR, for example. GDPR talks about 72-hour breach notification. Right? They've shortened the breach notification process in a big way. Right? That actually is the process which is going to help the collaboration. So there's one way where regulations are being tightened in that sense, which will bring out certain things which can help the broader ecosystem. Other ways to probably subtly articulate through the process in terms of the way the collaboration challenge that you have. Through the process without disclosing more specific pointed information of your organization.
Just to build on what Sheetal said, is that if we start looking at a bigger picture of what we want to really achieve as a goal, the possibility of us wanting to talk about the bad news in a way what we can and curtail it to what extent you really want to expose is something which can be thought of. Not sharing may be good at some point of time, but it's going to again hit 20 people and probably it's going to be getting much larger. Because now cyber attack is a profession. It's no longer a prank. It's no longer something, an ego massage. And when there is money in the business, people are really going to go after. So what they say is like, beimani ke dhande mein imandari badi hoti hai. So that is what is going to happen, and people are going to collaborate and keep going and going and going after it. So it's for us to be there, collaborating with a good intent and moving forward. I'll just take some part of the question and then if you want to take it. So I will take it more from a technology perspective. And for us as CyberArk, the collaboration works slightly differently. you know, it is the technology collaboration that we kind of start engaging. So we have a consortium which is called the C3 Alliance, which we work with all possible vendors, security vendors, and start building those pieces together. Now that's the collaboration from a technology side. From the people and the grievances and the enforcement side is something, you know, probably Sheetal, if you've got some view on it, you can put that.
Do you have any views which you want to share or before I talk about it? Yeah, so I will probably talk about this in terms of my experience outside India, and certainly there are aspects in India which are also happening here. But if you look at, say, for example, in the US, the FSISX that you have or the information sharing forums that you have, you definitely, instead of being pointed, you definitely can be broad-based and articulate your point of view through those engines and frameworks. Those frameworks are also out here in India, which you can definitely interlock with and kind of engage your organization within. Do you want to add anything, sir, Sangamesh?
Yeah. So primarily when you know, when we share such kind of things, I mean, every company has a thought like, you know, our identity will get revealed and our reputation would be at stake. But thinking aloud, like, you know, from a broader perspective, so we are sharing the intelligence for a better cause, so that our peers, our sector is apprised about the you know, attacks that I am you know, I am experiencing, and together with my own community, so I am ready for defending the attackers. So that thought should come. That's what.
Perfect. So any one of you want to take the...
I think sharing is the first thing that you need to avoid when you're into the security. And if you again get into that, probably, you know, if you have to share your identity with your give out the disinformation through internet, your IP is going to get caught. To Korea, you will get caught again where the courier is sent from. Again, if you are going to make a phone call, that also can be located. So there is no medium as such to, you know, you can comfortably share that information.
Let me just quickly share my point of view, and I will probably ask Sangamesh or Rohan also to talk about this. See, I come from a service industry, and I cater to approximately 600 to 800 customers today globally. Case, for example, when WannaCry happened, right? We are engaged with cert.in. We are engaged with all the ISACs in the various the geographies. We actually had a collaborative ecosystem which not just looked at the data, but also kind of moved the data or the information across to all the 700 customers, including the other engines like the ISACs and the cert or cert.in in a very, very effective manner. There are ways and means to interlock, and I will encourage you folks to look at how you kind of start. It has to start from you. If you start engaging, you will also find that there is an ecosystem which is willing to feed information into. The first step is for you to start the engagement process. Any other points that you want to make? Yeah, go ahead, please.
I just want to highlight and build upon what you just said. So primarily in North America and Europe, right now there are a lot of advancements in terms of how you can share incidents in a little more anonymous manner, because everybody is concerned about their reputation and brands. So much so that there are new formats called sticks and taxi, which have come into vogue. And you can basically share your very routine cyber incidents to actually big incidents like WannaCry. Not only the incident itself, but also the remediation that you had. And there are proper cyber incident exchanges, you know, which are actually aggregating all this data and then creating some kind of a layer of intelligence on top of it and then selling it, right? So there is a whole ecosystem that is very, very well built in North America and Europe, and which has completely taken away the stigma that is associated with, oh, there has been a cyber incident, now I should keep quiet. It's actually the reverse. The more you start sharing, the more you start learning back in terms of how you can actually prevent that incident. Just to give you an example, WannaCry, I mean, in most of the cases, it was as simple as those computers were not backed up. If you had backed up the data of those computers, ransomware cannot do anything to you. You just restore it from backup on a different laptop and start working as if nothing has happened. So simple solutions like this exist. It's just about looking at them proactively and then obviously contributing to it in a very proactive manner.
So taking the call, go ahead, please.
One practical scenario where, say, WannaCry is one example where I'm using particular product and there is a glitch in the product. Because of that, I got impacted and I'm doing a service for a customer. Now, the product guy doesn't want to immediately declare that there is a glitch in their product. And as a service person, I'm not very sure it's because of me or my service problem I haven't patched well, or it's because of the product there is a problem. So the collaboration doesn't happen immediately because everyone needs their own time to a root cause analysis. So no one want to give a false alarm at the initial stage. So there's a real challenge in the collaboration. If the product vendor immediately raises an alarm, it is easy for the service people to immediately recover from the problem. So there is really a challenge, right? So no one want to put themselves into trouble. So everyone want other guys to raise their hand, right?
Rohan, do you want to take that point?
Yeah, so I think it's more of a human nature.
Yeah.
Which we need to kind of start relooking at how we think, because it's like it's a trust-based industry which is now getting to. At the end of the day, if I don't trust you, you don't trust me, and that happens. I think that happened in IT for a long time. I was a part of IT for a long time till very recently that I moved to security, and that happened with every breach which opens.
Correct.
Everybody's blaming everybody, right? I think this is just a starting phase. And since this community is smaller, probably we're going to go through this learning curve and a trust curve much faster. I mean, that's my personal opinion on that.
Okay. And second question, we were talking about the GDPR, 72 hours for breach notification. So in the beginning of the conversation, you said that by the time a breach happens or an incident happens, by the time we complete the root cause analysis, it takes 100 days. But suddenly GDPR bring it to 72 hours. So is it realistic that it's possible to do from 100 days to 72 hours?
Right. So you have to understand the point I was making, so that you just make it little more clear there. The 100 days I talk about, 100 plus days, is identifying a breach to remediation process. The breach notification of 72 hours is you have identified the breach,
not remediate,
and then you have to notify in a period of 72 hours. To the point that she was making, the point I made is, look, today, when the breach happens, the tendency is to not talk about it.
Correct.
Right? Now you have regulations which are coming in, which will actually push you to communicate to the broader audience. Right? So 100 days, what happens, even if you really split the breach process, the breach identification takes a longer time of those 100 days. And then from the identification to remediation probably takes, depending upon the kind of breach, it may take from hours to days to probably a month, but not really the period of 100 days. I hope this clears your point. Let me shift the gears a little bit and talk about another critical point that our future state cyber defense center should think about. So how many of you here taken external threat feeds? Great. So there's a lot of folks who take in external feeds. Now, let me ask you further, one more drill down here. How many of you actually use these threat feeds and tightly integrated with your cyber defense centers? Perfect. So there's a good amount of hands. So Mr. Sangmesh, since you have been running the broader cyber defense center for Infosys, can you help us understand what are the focus areas to drive intelligence-based detection in your cyber defense center?
So primarily, as part of the security operations center, when we detect the incidents, so we wanted to bring in the context of the intelligence as well, so as to get the sense of like who is actually targeting us, which threat actor. Because the intelligence is going to give us the visibility of the threat actors and the IOCs and other artifacts as well. So once you have the conception of the intelligence provided by different commercial solutions provider, so you bring in the context of building the use case or the the case study for an incident itself. So who is attacking you, who is doing what kind of actions, and you would be able to profile the user or the attacker so that you can bring in the context of strengthening your controls. So say suppose some attackers would be interested in initiating application layer attacks, and you have the intelligence based on the logs that you get from your different servers. And you see like, okay, initially there has been a reconnaissance, and I'm seeing the specific attacker is initiating SQL injection attack. And just get that married with your intelligence on the threat actor profile and see like which are all the threat actors who will be doing such kind of activities. And it would be very easy for the analyst to correlate these two things and identify what would be the attacker's next move, so that you can bring in the essence of the simulating attack and see like what would be its next move, the attacker's next move, and also what kind of controls we have, whether my controls, my processes have the capability of detecting and protecting such attacks. So intelligence is nothing, is not something new. I mean, probably in this cyber, it is as a buzzword for past 3-4 years. But in ancient days, there would be a spy in other areas where they would be getting the information, whether that particular the other constituency is actually initiating a war against these people, and also those are the kind of intelligence that has been used in past. Now we are adapting onto the cyber in a similar way, where we are getting the IOCs and the threat actor profiles, everything beforehand, before even it made public. So those things are helping the enterprise for bringing up or scaling up their internal process to combat and defend the attackers.
Great, Mr. Sangamesh. I'm going to probably have one more aspect laid out in front of you, then which in turn covers various facets that we talked for the last probably 45, 50 minutes. And I'm sure a lot of you would have deeply studied the target breach which happened, right? Target had massively invested into security systems, and still they got breached. The most important factor is their CEO had to step down, taking the ownership of this breach. Now, this also brings to a very interesting point of how the organization has to build themselves up, keep considering that the organization's reputation is at risk. So, Rohan, keeping the business impact in mind, what do you think should be the organization structure, keeping in mind the new age cyber defense centers?
So, I mean, if you look at where we're moving to and the kind of business impact which can really happen by a cyber attack, and what he just mentioned about the CEO of Target stepping down, it's coming to a fact that the cyber defense center are eventually going to be the lifeline of business. And if this is a very bold and a strong statement, which basically is then provoking you to say that why doesn't a cyber security guy have a board seat? If I'm so important to the business, then I should be the person to the face to the board of directors in all conversations where there is going to be a business decision to be made. And the moment we have these conversations happening, then the relevance of the discussions of all business decisions are going to be in consensus of what the cybersecurity policies or the investments which are going to happen. I mean, we know today, as professionals, cybersecurity professionals, the last possible straw of money which is available is for the security. It's probably changing, it's probably improving, but as a vendor, I'm always frustrated because the budgets are being cut down. As the, on the other side, you know, people like Sangh are like saying, oh, you know, I wanted to do this, but I just don't have the money. Now, is that something really, really going to change over a period of time? And that can only change if there is somebody in the leadership team who's able to educate on the business impact. Saying, saving a few million dollars, if it is going to impact your $1 billion, it doesn't really happen. So that's something which from a organizational change, I think some organizations have started having the chief risk officers as a part of the board where, you know, cybersecurity is a part of it. Certain organizations, their CISO reporting has moved into the board. I think there is a movement which is happening in the industry, and probably, incidents of WannaCry and all these attacks which happen are probably going to just accelerate that. What, as cyber professionals, we probably need to is, again, start rescaling ourselves from a management skill in terms of being available and understanding the business, not just the cybersecurity part of it. So it's going to be both ways. There can be an organizational change which is going to happen and which is probably inevitable, but they will eventually need people who understand both the sides of the thing, business as well as cybersecurity. So, you know, it's a kind of a camouflaged dream that a CISO becomes a CEO at some point of time, not for a cybersecurity company, but more for a business world. And that's possibly happening because the focus of the business is all now on the internet. Everything which is there is connected with an IP, and that's where the world is moving. Thanks.
So, well said, Rohan. Ladies and gentlemen, if I have to really sum up the probably last 50-55 minutes of our conversation, there's a question? Yeah, please go ahead, please.
First point is what we are doing is a threat hunting. Okay, so myself, I've been leading up a SOC from last 7 years and all. I will point it out what I issued, I faced it up, and what you are building up the cyber defense center, that will not gonna solve your problem. I'm straightforward saying it out. Why? Human factor has always been involved. Maintaining the SLAs. Okay, what challenges I faced out, I find it out, this is the issue, this is gonna happen. Okay, and logged out the ticket, okay, this is the issue happen. But it will hang out into the manager queues, okay, the action needs to be taken up. It will gonna happen to the next service deliverable team or some kind of third party that need to be taken up the actions. So when you identify that action, okay, WannaCry has been happening or any kind of malware attack is happening or attacker has been attacking your servers. So something goes out, okay, the manager is not here. Or something, the person who has to deploy the patch, he's not here. That gap is still there. For suggesting up that point, we have to automate the action need to be taken also. Like if I find it out, there's a dark web is available, my account is got breached out. It is available, user ID and password available on the paste bin has been there. But what action we have been doing out with that? Okay, it's there, we have notified it. But is there any company who has taken that forward? Okay, I'm notified. To add further, there's another point, we are taking out data breaches. No one is notifying the data breaches. What I mean suggesting into this point is, yes, you notify the breaches. But to add up those things, notify what precautionary action you have taken, so this thing will not come up future. So this will not only kind of give you a negative point, but it will give you the chance to stable into the market. Okay, you are affected, but now you are fighting it. Many people, sorry to bring this thing up, many people die from the cancer and all. But who will be get reputed? Okay, he is fighting with the cancer and leading up the light. So if I find it out a kind of a breach in the data, but now, yes, I have patched it up, I have made it out, I have resetted all the users, it is now fixed.
So that's well said. And instead of having my eminent panelist, in the interest of time, talk about this, I'll just make one point and we can discuss it further offline. As Rohan said, if you bring up security top down, security is everybody's business in an organization. It's not yours and mine business. Right? If you're able to drive security top down, you will actually have enough and more stakeholders working for you. That's the problem to solve. If you're able to effectively drive it top down, you will solve that problem. And effectively, net, there will be the teams who will actually really work for you to effectively handle the incident. Now, having said that, we'll definitely take that offline. Having said that, I know in the interest of time, I have to really wrap up here. So if really have, if I'll just take, just summarize what we discussed. If really we have to drive ourselves to the next level, drive the change, we have to focus on the five basic principles. We have to improve our detection process through usage of new age techniques. We have to improve our response process through automation and orchestration. We have to look at competencies and enable our competencies to next level, including awareness, which should be driven top down. We have to drive ourselves through intelligence and really map intelligence into the detection process very, very effectively. And lastly, we have to change behavior. Behavior is very important, and that's a people-centric function. Whether it's collaboration, whether it's internal movement and internal collaboration, that's a shift in behavior that has to happen. Once again, I think... since